choosing an AR wearable that suits your needs isn't just a matter of choosing a specific model from a specific brand. There are many more choices that are relevant and important. And that is because the way we will be using AR in the future differs from the way we are using AR right now. Currently, much of our AR usage is task-based. So we put on an AR wearable where we need assistance with something, where we need very accurate 3D tracking. A device like this one, the Microsoft HoloLens, is needed. But a heavy device like this is not suitable to wear throughout the day. But when AR glasses will get smaller, we might start wearing them 24/7. These devices will include a camera that sees what you see, but even though they're not going to record your whole life, they will scan your environment and recognize objects. And all the data will be sent to the cloud to be processed, to understand where you are and what's going on. So the glasses will show AR appearances in the world around you, but not everything can or needs to be expressed in that way. So foremostly, you will interact with your device on the heads-up display. That's a virtual transparent screen floating in front of you. And there you will see relevant information or tips about your current context. So for example, when you're meeting people, they're analyzed. So you might see how they're doing. You might see when you previously met them. And their social media feed is, of course, processed. You might even get suggestions on what to say to them. So the device isn't just sitting on your nose waiting for you to use it. It is proactively trying to be helpful. It will inform you and guide you and warn you. It will be telling you what to do or what not to do. People in factories are already used to this, but in our case, these devices will streamline our personal lives. And to do that well, a lot of data is needed. So to function properly, the device really needs to understand you as a human being, what you're doing, what you like. And to get this understanding, it requests the obvious data, your location, your agenda, where you need to go and when, who you're meeting, what you're doing during the day. So perhaps it can even detect your tone of voice and match that with the activities it sees you performing. And of course, you will be asked for your permission, but you have to agree to share all the data. The device needs to understand you really well so it can make the right decisions and recommendations. And of course, that is not what you want. You don't want an external script or AI system, a black box, to run your life. But there is no middle way. You can't just share a little bit of data because then the service won't be good enough. But if you don't want to share the data, then you need to become the black box. But cutting ties to the services offered to you by big tech will be difficult after the cloud has been observing you for years, gathering lots of data about you and doing analysis on it. So that means that after a while, it will become very difficult to switch or quit without losing the level of quality that you're used to. We're concerned about our relationship with big tech already when we are influenced by what we are seeing on web pages, but the problematic dependency might even be worse when it concerns the virtual screens in front of us that direct us through many of our day-to-day activities. So with present-day AR devices, we're not experiencing that problem yet, but it will become an issue once we gradually let these AR devices play a more significant role in our life. And this problem seems far away, and the present-day discussions are making clear that a clear fix solution cannot easily be found, a quick fix. But there's an urgency to prepare an exit from big tech that can only be achieved if we start gathering our own massive amount of data. And that is not something we should do at a later time. Companies might disappear. They will warn you to grab your data, but you might forget to do so. So you need your own pool of data, because then you will have a chance to switch to another service in the future. And that wouldn't be possible if these life-influencing scripts that you're running on your AR device can't function properly because they're not having access to a significant amount of data to analyze about you. So together, it's important to start collecting data yourself. So setting a reminder might help for monthly or weekly downloads of your Google data, for example, and the data from your fitness tracker and soon also the data your AR device will produce by analyzing everything in your environment. Managing your own pool, your own data pool, also has the benefit that you're not just collecting basic data, but you can be in control about the extra data that is being extrapolated from it, the insights, the conclusions, and the classifications. So big tech does this about you, but it never fully discloses all that it knows about you. When requested, they might let you download your original raw data, but when doing data gathering yourself, you can see which conclusions are drawn from your data. You can inspect and correct those. You can monitor the AI learning process once in a while. And the benefit of working on your own black box and data is you can trust it. You can even add data to it that you won't share with a cloud that you don't trust. So we are not wearing AR glasses yet, but on the beyourownrobot.com website, you can find a smartphone app that lets you enter this kind of data, soft data. This might include data about how you feel, your mood, your level of confidence or hope. And that is data that big tech can only guess about you by tracing your online activities and the occasional like button you click. But by providing it yourself, you can be sure it's correct and complete. And the true value of knowing this data can be unlocked in combination with the raw data. Both types of data mutually enrich each other. So if you're analyzing your activities by just looking at your whereabouts, what does that say? But if the data can be combined with the soft data about how you were feeling at a specific place in a specific context, that could lead to a much better understanding of you. And it should be big tech getting to know you so well. It should be you. And that takes away a lot of worries. You don't have to hold back when choosing the scripts and functions on your AR wearable that might be useful for you, even influencing your life. What can these apps and features be? Much of the current examples we hear about and the ones we see have some sort of business model included in the concept. Otherwise, they can't exist. But when becoming independent from big tech, looking for AR smartness from the open source community, for example, we have the luxury to skip worrying about the business aspects. And we can put ourselves in the center of our thinking about our wishes. Imagining what to do with a personal digital assistant that knows you really well and that you can trust. It might seem easy, but it's actually quite a challenge to find out what you really want. With which tasks may it help you? Do you want to have a very stubborn guide, knowing very well what's best for you, or do you want it to act just as expected? But what's the use then? Or do you want to be confronted with alternatives or new viewpoints and be surprised? So it's going to be a very personal choice, and that means that also the required data to serve you properly differs very much from person to person. And you might be using specific software or devices that produce data that you want to include in your data pool to help your external intelligence to know you better. So with so many different preferences and possible devices that might produce data that's relevant for you, it's very unlikely that there will ever be one big system that will arrange this all for you. So even commercial companies only collect the data about you that's relevant for their specific goals and services. And even if they're handling one type of data about us in a satisfactory way, we can't oblige tech companies to keep a copy of all that data during our lifetime. So this data needs to be moved somewhere by you. Companies won't do it, and neither can we expect this to be done automatically by some magic government-owned system that keeps track and backups every bit of data of all its citizens. Also grabbing data from all kinds of devices we choose to buy and use and trying to keep up with the latest versions and updates. So it seems this is going to be something to manage on your own, choosing bits and pieces of software that do the things you need. It will be a patchwork of data sets with incompatible formats. But there will probably be plugins for that once we need them doing the required conversions. Something that worries me more is the openness of this this hardware, the AR wearables. Will you be able to bypass the official software, not sharing anything to the cloud to which your device belongs? Can you use the camera for your own apps and plugins? Or will it be time for a AR glasses jailbreaking club to provide access to this to the camera? Or will that be forbidden because a strict closed ecosystem and an unbreakable camera usage policy is the only way to accept these devices in public space and be confident about them respecting our privacy? Well, AR glasses will be presented to us as devices that will make our life super easy, but the reality of augmented reality glasses might be a little different. And of course, you can decide not to think too much about it. And of course, you can accept the default settings, or maybe there might be several government approved default profiles. So you can rely on a set of scripts and software that makes you a proper semi-digital citizen. And of course, you can choose not to wear AR glasses at all for the time being. But if these devices are like the smartphones some people tried to ignore 20 years ago, most of them who never wanted to have a phone eventually started using them. So, but whatever the thing is we wear in 10 years' time, be it glasses or perhaps smart lenses, it's not a good idea to sit still and do nothing for 10 years' time. Because meanwhile, the data gathering machine is working for you. And even when you're not planning to wear glasses, escaping from big tech is something that is a challenge for many of us. Technology and software is running our life. We're living in a digital age, and it takes an effort to be your own robot.